Hello everyone and welcome to this brand new course on graphic designing. Under this course, we will cover three software: Illustrator, Photoshop and Flash. So to start the course, I will start with Illustrator. Now what Illustrator is for? Why do we even use it? So if you make infographics, then Illustrator is a good choice for you. And if you are into print media, then Illustrator is a must. I mean, print media, it happens a lot in print media, that resolution problem or some color corrections and all. So that can be very well handled with Illustrator. So I think in print media, Illustrator is must. Then if we go for website designing stuff, then if you are into website designing and something, then Illustrator is a good option because you can create your entire website mockups in Illustrator. And later on, you can convert those mockups into a website using HTML, CSS, or jQuery, and all those languages you need. Then if you are into illustrations and cartoons, then Illustrator is a good choice. I mean, I do a lot of cartoons in Illustrator. I especially work on sketches and all. So converting those sketches into cartoons, Illustrator can be great help in that section. So with that said, let's start the installation process. To install the software, first of all, we need a setup. To get the setup, we have to register ourselves on Adobe website. So I have this website opened here. So all you have to do is open your browser and in the address bar, type www.adobe.com. Once you type in the address, the website will appear on your browser. I'm already signed in. Let me show you how to sign in or create your new account. Okay. So yeah, here we have our website opened without signing in or anything. So on the top right, you see this link which says sign in. I'll just click on it. And from there, it will navigate you entire different page where it says sign in. So if I have already registered on the website, I can just sign in. And if you are a new member or it's your first time on the website, you can click on Get Adobe ID. So I'll click on this right now. And it opened a page which says sign up. Now here you can fill all your details like your first name, last name, email address, your password, your country, date of birth and all. And then you can click on sign up. Adobe will send a verification mail to your mail ID. From there you have to verify your mail ID and then you will be registered on the website. Since I am already registered, I am not going to sign up again. So I am going to close this window and I am going to log into my existing account. Let's just enter password real quick and yeah. So there we go. I am signed into Adobe website now. Now the version we are using for Illustrator is CC 2014. The latest version they have is CC 2015, which includes Creative Cloud. I'm not going to cover that part right now. What we are using is CC 2014. So in another tab, I have this link opened already. I leave this link in the description. You can just navigate to this link. And when you open this, it will navigate to the page says Adobe Illustrator CC 2014 release Windows 32-bit. I am only managed to find 32-bit version. If you manage to find 64-bit version and if your operating system is 64-bit version, then you can download a 64-bit version, there's no problem. With coming to the Windows, I am using Windows 7 as an operating system. You might be having Windows 8 or Windows 10 with you. That's completely fine. Software isn't going to change on different platforms. But if you are a Mac user, then you have to notice that there will be some changes within the software in terms of like how everything looks and how everything is arranged. And there are some controls which are different. But it's not very major. You can still refer to these videos and by the time we cover this entire course, you will be able to rectify all these changes by yourself. It's not very major. Plus for Mac users, what you have to be careful about, whenever I say control for Windows, that means command key on Mac. And whenever I say alt key on Windows, that means option key on Mac. That's the only thing you have to be careful about. Otherwise, rest all, you can just refer to the video. It will be beneficial for you also. So, I'm going to click on download now. It is 1619 MB of file and 1.6 GB almost. And then it opens a dialog which is asking me for file to save. I can click on save file and click on OK. Now, this is a big file, 1.6 GB and my net speed is not very fast. So, it might take a while for me to download. So I'm gonna cancel it because I have already downloaded it. You can click on OK and start the download. Now once download completes, you will see a zip file in your download folder or wherever you have saved your file. So what you have to do after that is right click on that zip file and say extract all. These instructions are for Windows user. For Mac it will be different. Right click on the zip file and click extract all. Once you have done that, it will create a folder, something like this. Now open this folder and inside that you will find this setup.exe. So this is the executable file which will install software on your system. So just double click on it and it will take a while to load. Alright, so after that loading window, this window appears which has two options, install and try. Now if you have bought the software already, you can click on install. And if you are a first time user or if you want to try the software first, then you can try. It will install for 30 days trial period. After that you have to buy the software. I recommend first try the software before buying it. I mean, you should know what software it is and whether I want to continue this software and is this the software I'm looking for. Once you are sure about that, then go ahead and buy it. So we are going to click on try now. And now it is asking me to sign in. So let's sign in with our mail ID. I have already signed in once on this setup, so it isn't asking me for username and password, but for you it will ask you your username and password. So just enter your username and password for Adobe website and it will sign you in. After that, this is end license agreement, so just read through it and click on accept. Now I have a 64-bit installation version, so it is showing me two options, 64-bit and Adobe Illustrator CC. So what you have downloaded right now is 32-bit version. So this option might not appear in your setup. If you manage to find 64-bit version, that's good enough. I mean, if you have 64-bit Windows, that will fairly run on your system and there will be no problem with it. So I'm going to install only 32-bit version right now. Now it is asking me for installation directory. So C, program files, Adobe. I generally install all my software in C drive. So this is good for me. Now I'm going to click on install. So once you click on install, it will install the software automatically and then you are ready to open your software. Now I'm not clicking on install here because I have already software installed with me. So I'm just gonna close this setup right now. And before moving further, I assume that you have already downloaded and installed your software. So once done that, let's open Illustrator. So I click on start and there are two ways to open this. Either you can go to all programs and click on Adobe Illustrator CC, or you can just type over here Illustrator. So it is showing me Adobe Illustrator CC 64-bit. So yeah, this is what I want. So I just click on it and software will open in a while. When you open Illustrator first time, this is the interface you get. Now what is this interface and what all it does and how it works, we are going to cover it today itself. So let's start with the top panel, which has a menu bar on the left side and few keys on the right side, like close button and maximize, minimize, restore buttons, and a search bar and few workspace options. Now what is this workspace and what all it does? We will cover it today. On the bottom right side, I have this, or on the right side itself, I have this panel bar. There are so many sub panels in it. How it works, we will cover it in later chapters. On the left side, we have this toolbar, and we will use a lot of them. I mean, we will be aggressively using all these tools, and we will cover each of them one by one. So don't worry about that. This is my canvas in the middle. This entire gray border is my canvas. If I want to create a new file, let me just quickly jump and just create a new file first of all, and then we'll come to other part. So file and new. Now it opens another dialog which says new document and it has loads of settings. I'm not going to worry about it right now. I'm just gonna skip it for a moment and we'll again come back to them. Just click on OK. Now it has created a new file and with a new tab which says untitled 1 at 145% CMYK preview. What all this is, we'll cover it, or you will understand it over the time. You will automatically understand. So this is my canvas now, and I can actually draw things over here. Previously, if I don't have anything over here, these tools will not work at all. So I need some file that I can draw and do things. So this is the canvas where I draw everything. So let's just delete it. And so now to start with, it is important to notice that Illustrator is a vector-based software. Now there is another kind of software which is called raster-based software. Now what is the difference between vector and raster? Let's take an example. I will draw two shapes over here. One is rectangle and one is circle. Don't worry what I am doing right now. It's you can just ignore it right now. We'll cover all these things in later videos, that you will be able to draw your own shapes and export your own things. So right now I am exporting. Control Shift E, Alt E, and let's export in another file format which is untitled 1, and let's export. It is asking for some settings. Just ignore them right now. Like I said, I'm repeating myself again and again, but we'll cover it in future videos. So let's just import that file back again over here. And now we can compare between raster and vector graphics. Now on the left we have vector graphic, on the right we have raster graphics. You might ask, how can I say them? What is the difference between both of them? Let's select both of them and scale them. Scale them really big. Now if you see, this on the left hand side are vector graphics which I created in Illustrator. And on the right is raster graphics. So you can see these blurry lines or blurry edges around the circle, or even in the rectangle, the straight line is got blurred actually. Wherever in vector graphics, there is no such quality loss or quality compression. See, even if I zoom in to any level, there is no quality loss, or it's still very clear. So that makes vector graphics scalable. You can scale them to any extent and they will not lose their quality. But these raster graphics actually, they are scale dependent. So if you have exported them on a certain resolution, or you have your file on a certain resolution, let's say 1920 by 1080, then you cannot scale it beyond that. You can obviously drop down the size, but if you increase the size of a file, then you're definitely going to have quality loss. And that's why Illustrator is an excellent choice if you are into print media, because you don't know, let's say you have something to print and you don't know what all sizes we are going to print it in. Maybe it will be in A3, A4 and A1 sheets. So you just assume the general size A3. And you created your entire document. Then later on you come to know that, okay, I have to print this design on A1 papers or A1 size sheets. So what all you can do is just grab your entire design and scale it for A1 size. And that's it. There will be no quality loss, nothing. You can just, your file is just ready to print. And again, this this image formats like JPG and .png, .tga, these are raster based image formats. So when I come to software like Illustrator, CorelDRAW, Flash are vector based, and software like Photoshop, GIMP, and these software like raster based software. If you are into sketching or something, then there is a software called Mischief. It is a vector based sketching software. If you sketch a lot, you might want to go and check it out. It is excellent software. I use it a lot for my sketching. Alright, so knowing about difference between raster and vector graphic, let's get back to our interface. So Adobe Illustrator has a very, I can say, good interface, or you can say customizable, where you can actually customize things the way you want. How can you customize? We'll come to that point. But first we'll start with each of them in detail. So like I was saying, on the top you have menu bar. So all this file, edit, object, type, select, effect, view, window and help are your menus. And when you click on one of them, then it opens a list of sub menus. So every one of them has a list of sub menus. Like if I go to select, it has all on active artboard, deselect, reselect, inverse. Now what it all does when we come to select part, we'll going to cover it. And then effect, view, and like you can see each of them have a lot of sub menus. Now if you notice, few of these sub menus has this arrow, black colored arrow pointing to the right. So this is like this sub menu has further sub menus in it. So if I go to effects and I go to artistic, so there are like much more effects within this artistic effect itself. So menu and then sub menu and then sub menu, and it might happen that you may find another sub menu within it, like in this one actually. When you go to brushes library, it has a sub menu and again it has one more sub menu, so like that. So that's how you navigate to your menu bar. Then below that we have this option bar. Now if you would have noticed, when there was no file here, there was actually no option bar also. But when I created a file, I got an option bar. So option bar is actually tool dependent. So if you have your tool selected, then that this option bar will show you options for that respective tool. Like if I have selection tool selected, it is showing me options for this tool. And if I have text tool selected, then it is showing further options for this tool. That what all options do I have for text tool. Alright, so next jump to the toolbar. So on the left we have this toolbar, and all these tools we have, how they work and how can we use them, we'll look into it in future chapters or future videos. On the right hand side we have this panel bar. The next part, at the bottom part we have this one more bar appeared. It appeared when we created a new file. So it has some percentage and it has some this 1, 2, 3, 4 marking on it. Now what all is this is, we'll cover it as soon as we start learning artboards and canvas navigation. We'll come to this part. So with our workspace and interface concept clear, let's just see one more functionality of Adobe Illustrator. So this time I'm going to open multiple files. Let me just open 3 or 4 files real quick. And what all I'm doing is clicking on file, new, and I'm just clicking on OK. And I have some 6 files with me right now. Now on the top middle, you can say there is one button called arrange documents. If you want to see a tooltip of anything in Illustrator, you just drag your mouse over that icon or over that button or anywhere, and just leave it there. It will show you a tooltip for that, and also a shortcut key. Like if on the toolbar, if you drag it, it will show it shortcut key along with the name of the tool. On the panel, it will show you the name of the panel. And here, like it is showing me the name, it says arrange documents. So okay, I just click on this, and now it has so many options in it. What all this is, it will arrange. So let's say if I have all my multiple documents open, so what this will do is it will arrange my documents in such a way that all of them visible in a single window. So like right now I can just see one of them at a time. So either I can see Untitled 7 at a time or Untitled 8. Right now they all look same. I'm just gonna draw a rectangle in all of them and change color so that it makes more clear that which document I am in right now. So Control C and paste it over here, change the color to this. Change the color to this. Change the color to this. I'm just copying the shape and pasting it again and again So that I have same rectangle but different color. So it will help me to differentiate between documents. So yeah, now I have this rectangle and this. So now I can see that all these files have different colors of rectangle. And now I can only view one file at a time. What if I want to compare between files and I want to see all of them at a time and see, okay, this is what is happening in this file and this is what is happening in this file. So there we can use this cascading style or which is arrange documents button. So right now this one is selected, which is one window on the screen. If I select this one, the second button beside it, then let's just click on it and release. So you see I have so many documents opened at a time. Now how am I navigating the document? We'll come to it in next after this. So now I have all my documents here in the same window. So like this, there are so many styles. If you want vertical columns, so these are vertical columns. If you want horizontal, then these are horizontal columns. And if you want only two files at a time, so this will show you two files at a time. So one is this, and I think you can drag and drop your tabs from here and there. And yeah, so you have like you have like two sets of files now. Let's say if this is one set of file and it is having similar kind of design, and it is another, let's say if these sets of file have circle and these sets of file have rectangle, so you can just compare between them two, that what is actually going on between these two sets. And similarly, you have now three files vertically arranged, you can say column wise arranged at a time, and you can just distribute the files from one column to another. And like this, there are so many options. There are different options actually. You can explore between all of them and you can see what all do you need at a time and what suits you best. So I use them occasionally, but most of the time I work on this. I like this kind of arrangement where one file at a time. Even if I want to compare, I generally export them and compare it in images. So everyone has a personal preference. So you might be, you might want to compare them at the same time. I don't. So it's up to you. All right. So that understood. Let's now go to navigation controls. That how can I navigate my canvas? And if I want to zoom in, zoom out, and all that stuff. At the bottom we have this 150%, which says which is actually my current zoom level. So let's say if you have opened a document which is of a smaller size, or which is of like a very small size, 600 by 400 pixels. So what Illustrator, when you open a file in Illustrator, it automatically fits the document to your screen. Let's like this document is fit to my screen. And so what happens when you create a new file, Illustrator will fit the document to your screen to a certain zoom level. Let's say my document is at 150 zoom level, but if you want to see the original size of your document, then it should be on 100%. So what I can do is click on this bottom facing arrow, and from here I get this 6400, 4800. I can just look for 100% and there. So this is the actual size of my document. But when I zoom in, it gets fit to my screen. So anyways, it doesn't matter much because Illustrator is anyways vector based software. So you won't be having any quality differences. You won't see any quality differences. Well, it's good to know that, to know the original size of your document. The other way to zoom in and zoom out is control negative and control positive. So if you want to zoom out, you have to press control key on your keyboard and hold it down and then press negative key or minus key at the same time. The minus key can either be on your numpad or can either be above your or can either be your with your numeric keys where you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 above QWERTY keys. So control and hold negative key, sorry, not hold, press negative key, hold control and press negative key. So it will zoom out. And alternatively, when you press control key, keep pressing control key and press plus to zoom in. So control negative for zoom out, control positive for zoom in. So that's those are zoom in, zoom out options. Now, if you want your window, if you want to fit your document, like when you open a unified, it is like fit to document. So if you want to do that, then you have to press control 0. So that what it does, it fits your document on the screen. So let's say you have navigated somewhere and you actually lost your document. Your canvas went out of your screen, and you don't know where is your where is your document. So press control 0 and it will appear on your screen. Now how can I navigate to the canvas like I just did? So for that you have to press space on your keyboard. So notice when I press space, my hand changes to my cursor changes to a hand, and when I click, it grabs the canvas. So to navigate, what you have to do, press space, click, and then move around, move your mouse, so you can now navigate your canvas the way you want. Again, I repeat, press space and left click, and then move around, so to navigate your canvas. Alternatively, you can use these scroll bars, this horizontal and vertical, this vertical and horizontal scroll bars. So that will do the same thing, but the limitation with scroll bar is you can only navigate on one single line. It's not like when holding the space, you can navigate to anywhere you want. But when you scroll with the scroll bars, you can navigate either up, down, or you can either navigate to left, right. So it's again personal preference, whichever suits you best, go with that. I generally like holding space and left mouse click. That works best for me. And control negative, control positive for zoom in, zoom out. You can have your own options, that's no problem. Now another thing, another way we can navigate to the canvas is using a navigation window. So what we'll do is click on window in the menu bar, and we'll look for a panel called navigator. So here we have this panel. Let's just click on it and it opened, but in the okay. So here is the navigator window. So you see this red line or red rectangle. This is actually showing the area which is visible to my in my canvas over here on my screen. So when I go inside this red rectangle, my hand changes, my cursor changes to a hand, and the same way I was dragging with space, holding space bar and left mouse click, the same way I can do it. Except this time I don't have to press any space bar, I can just click inside this rectangle and I can drag around. So this does the same thing. And at the bottom you see this big mountain and small mountain. This is for zoom in and zoom out. Either you can just scroll through this, and this will do the same thing. I think there is a bug over here that it is not reflecting the changes. Yeah, it is, but it's taking some time. Okay, so either you can use the scroll bar, click on buttons, or navigate through here. So like we just see, for navigation itself, if you want to navigate or zoom in, zoom out to your canvas, there are three ways to do that. And if you mix those three ways, it makes some 3 into 3 and I don't know, I think it's perhaps 27 ways to navigate your canvas itself. So one thing to be careful about in Illustrator, that there may be various ways to do a single thing, and it might happen in future also that you want to create something and you have an approach, you have a plan for it, that how you are going to do it, but another person has a different plan or different approach to do the same thing. So all are right. Unless you are getting the result, it's all right. There can be several approach to do the same thing. So it's not like one approach is right and one approach is wrong. It's just a personal preference and how you get the result and how you get the final result.
It's all up to that.
Okay, so after that, let's move on to file menu. Now I have so many files opened here, so I'm going to close them one by one. So it is asking me whether you want to save the file or not. I don't want to save these files right now. So I keep on pressing no again and again till all of them are closed. So let's start from the beginning, how we create a file and what all options I have to create a new file, and how can I save it, how can I open new file. So let's start with that. To open a new file, what you have to do is click on file, and then when the sub menu opens, you have to click on new. Either you can do this or you can press Ctrl N on your keyboard. Both will do the same thing. And with that open, it will it will open a new dialog. It says new document. Now I have these options here. So the first one say name. So here I can name my document. What name do I want for my document? So let's say I name it demo. D-E-M-O. Okay. Just a minute. D-E-M-O. Alright. So this is the name for my file. Now it says profile. So let's see what this profile says. Click on this, and it has some options saying print, web, devices, video, film, and basic RGB. Now it solely depends on what kind of work you are doing. Let's say if you are doing some website mock-up, or if you are doing some banner for a website, then you might want to select web over here. If you are doing advertisement, or you are creating a pamphlet or something, or something for printing, then print is a good option. If you are creating something for video films, or like you are creating some kind of effects or some kind of 2D graphics, which you can say a rollover which just appears on the screen for a while and then it disappears, then video and film can be selected. Devices is generally for devices like mobile phones and for Android, iPhones and all. And basic RGB is just another style where you get RGB as a default color mode. Now what is RGB? We will cover it when we'll come to our color schemes and how do we color everything. So for now, I am sticking to the default one, which says print. So I just selected print. Now it says number of artboards. Now what is this artboard? Actually, when we created a file, there was a white rectangle, and then there was black border around it. So now what is this artboard? I will come to it when we just create a file. I'll tell you what is the artboard. So for now, let's just keep it one. And then these things are disabled. Why these are disabled and how it works, we'll come to them when we'll talk about artboards. And here it's asking about the size. So right now it's letter. I can go for legal, tabloid, A4, A3, B5, B4. Generally, I go with letter, because I don't have any specific requirements right now. So let's just go with the letter. Then it's showing this width and height. So this is the default width and height for the letter. If I select A4, then this is showing 595.28 and some other numbers. If I select B4, the numbers has changed. So this is the dimensions for the letter. The units can be points, picas, inches, millimeters, centimeter, and pixels. So let's go with pixels and letter. All right. Now for orientation, we have two modes here. Let's just look at these modes real quick. So first I select this portrait mode and I click OK. So I get my document like this. Now I'm creating again a new file, and this time I'm selecting a portrait mode, landscape mode. So the second one is landscape mode, and click on OK. So I have my document like this, rotated 90 degrees. Okay, so let's close these two files again, and Again, we are here on a new document screen, name it demo, and rest all settings are same. Or go to paint, make it letter, go to pixels, okay. Now one thing we have here, the last thing which we haven't covered is this bleed. Now if you are into print, then this bleed might help you a lot. What it does is, or I'll create two examples to show this. So first of all, let's say we keep a bleed 0 and click OK. So it created a file, and this time what I'll do is, let's say print and letter and pixels, and this time I'm setting bleed to 5 pixels, let's say, and it changed in all these four boxes. I mean, I pressed 5 in one of this text box, but it changed everywhere because we have this link button on. So I pressed OK anyways, and because I'm fine with having 5 pixel of bleed at all the sides. So now you can see we have this red rectangle around this our whole document. Now this is actually a bleed area. Now how can it help when you are printing a document, and after printing, what happens is if you have your document in bulk printing or something, and you have to cut it out. I mean, when you cut it into an A4 size or letter size, sometimes the edges got trimmed while cutting. So you can set your bleed to some ratio. So what it will do is it will create some extra space for printing. So this will be your actually print area. And when you are actually cutting your print to a letter size, then even if by accident some edges got chopped off, it won't affect your design at all. Otherwise, there are chances that your design might get cut while cutting down the edges of the paper. So yeah, that's how bleed helps. Now we'll talk about this link, what it does. When this is on, then all these four boxes will have same value. If I change a value in any of these boxes, so it will be reflected in just three of them. Now if I want asymmetric values, then I can click on this link. Now this icon got changed and there is like broken sign over here. So I can have my custom values over here. Let's say this is 20 pixels, this is 10, this is 5, and on the top we have 0 pixel of bleed. So let's click OK. So now you can see this rectangle got created, but it's very asymmetric. It's not symmetric like before. Like before we were having 5-10 pixels of bleed all over the place. Now it is very irregular. There's like 20 pixels of bleed here, 10 pixels of bleed here, 5 pixels of bleed here, and 0 on the top. So again, it depends on your project requirements or work requirement. How do you want to do it? It's all up to you. Alright, so with that complete, now let's just say 0 to bleed. I don't want this right now. And open the advanced options. Now in advanced options, let me just select print media first, letter and pixels. Okay, now in advanced options, we have this color mode, raster effects and preview mode. Now color mode is CMYK by default. If you want RGB, you can select it. Again, like I said, we are going to color modes in our later chapters when we talk about colors. Raster effects are like 300 ppi, 150 and 720. This will be beneficial when you have some images in your documents, because like I said, images have raster mode in them, like JPG and all, they work on raster based technology, or these images are like raster based. So if you have any images in your document, then you might want to select 300 ppi. 72 will actually drop down the quality of your images a lot, and it might not come very well in the when you actually print them. So I generally keep it 300 ppi because it doesn't affect the performance much, and it's good for better quality. Preview mode, pixel overprint, what are these? We'll cover them in later chapters. Right now, don't bother about them. Then just click on OK. So this is how we have created. This is how we create our new file. And now, like I was talking about artboard. So this white area is called the artboard. This thing is artboard, and this gray area around. This is our canvas. So you can say this entire thing is our canvas, and this white thing is our artboard. So let's jump it to again, and now let's say if what will happen if I say I want two artboards. So I just change the value 2 and let's click on OK. So there we go. I have two artboards now. Now how can it be useful? In the similar way, I can have like 6 artboards at a time. And now I can arrange the spacing. The spacing is how much space do you want between artboards and columns. How many columns do you want? So let's say we'll have 3 columns. So you can see we have 3 columns right now and 20 pixels of space between them or 20 points. Now again to my question, why do we use artboards? Why do we even need them? Let's say you have some kind of design for some website or any of your mobile application and you want to make alternate versions of it. Artboards is a good option over there. Because you have your design over one artboard and you can copy and paste the same design over to another artboard. Let's just create a circle over here and I'm gonna color it red. So let's just say this is my design. It looks very beautiful though. And now I want to have alternate versions of this this design. So what I can do is I can put it in another artboard and I can change color of it to something else, and I'm trying out the options what looks best and what not. So like this we can have so many designs or so many alternate versions of the same thing in a single file. And like before we were doing cascading, we were arranging all the files in the same workspace trying to get the thing done right, that how will all these files look at same time. So this is an alternate option for that. You can have artboards in one single file, and when you open all of them load at the same place, and this will actually be more convenient for you to either show a preview to your clients or give demos on your designs and all. So this is a good option if you want to have alternate versions or alternate variations of your designs. Alright, so we will cover artboards in details. I mean, if you want to change the size and all, artboard options and everything. But for now, just a basic knowledge of artboard is good. Yeah, now let's say we have created a new file, and now if I want to save it, what should I do? So to save a file, you can just press Ctrl S to save the file, or go to File and here Save. It says Ctrl S as a shortcut, so just click on it. Now it will ask you for the location, where do you want to save it. I click on Desktop and the name is Untitled File. So let's say I name it day1.ai. Now .ai is the extension of your Illustrator file. So like in Windows we have extension for every kind of file. .exe for executable and .txt for text document. So similarly AI is for Illustrator. So okay, click on save, and now this will show you some options which says Illustrator CC 17.0. This is my version of Illustrator, so it is asking me this is the latest version. And you have legacy formats over here also. Let's say if you have the latest version of Illustrator and you are moving your file to some other system, and there you have Illustrator CS5 installed, so you might want to save it in legacy format so that it can be opened there, otherwise the file won't open. But again, if you save it in CS5 format, it will show you a warning. It says, saving to legacy format may cause some changes to your text layout and disable some editing features when the document is read-backing. So actually, saving legacy format disables some of the things. I have experienced it myself when It actually merges your groups and so many things. Actually, it affects text a lot. You won't be able to edit your text, or the fonts will go all over the place. So it happens sometimes, and you might want to be careful about that between moving your files from higher version to a lower version. But it's good to know these options are available, and if you want to do it in future, if you need it, it's good to know. So I'm gonna save it in Illustrator CC 17.0 format version, and subset fonts and everything 100%, and create a PDF compatible file. Yeah, just check it on. These all are default settings, so I'm not going to change it much. And just click on OK, and there we have our file. It's on another screen. Just a minute. So there we have our file saved, day1.ai. To open this file, I can either double click on it, or I can open Illustrator, go to File, Open, and open it from here. So we have our file open. So that's it for today. We'll cover rest of the parts in future videos. I hope you enjoyed the video. Also, this is like my first recording, so it might be not very proper, and my English might be all over the place. So I promise I will improve over the future, and I hope I see you in the next video. Goodbye.